morning.
Good morning.
Welcome to Maple's Chapel Concert Service. I'm so pleased to have you this morning. Do we have any guests this morning? Apparently some people did not change the class over. So we will pray for them this morning. Today we will have fellowship in the annex after the services, and all are invited. Matter of fact, I put another little fee in the bank for you because you will need to eat the bagels. We have sufficient bagels for everyone this morning. There will be no Bible study. And if you will look in your bulletin, you should have a form for Easter lilies. We're asking you to do the same as we did for the poinsettias for Christmas. Fill out the form. And the process will be that you take the form home, fill it out, bring it back the 20th, no later than the 27th of March, and turn it in. And make it out to Skyland Florist. They will accept checks from us. That's a check out in the United States.
A local check with
the
phone number.
Okay, a local check with the phone number. Please just go over there so that we can have that is for our search day. And of course, you know, you pay for the letters, the letters will belong to you. Parish Council met the first Sunday, and one of the recommendations from the Parish Council is that we not conduct our neighborhood group of invitations in April or May, but we move it to September or October time frame. And the reason for that is we want the new people who are coming in over the summer to get invitations for us. And what we're planning to do is cover the Normandy area and invite those people to come to serve with us for one particular service. Do we have anyone in here who is a member of the Association of the United States Army? I want to bring that up because it came out yesterday, a couple of days ago, that they have $340,000 to give away in scholarships. So if you have anyone that's connected to you in your family, that person can apply for a scholarship from the AUSA, Association of the United States Army. Now, all please stand, meet, and greet each other in the name of the Lord.
Thank you.
Well, good morning.
Glad you all remembered to set your
clocks forward on this very cold, strange morning. Glad it warmed a couple weeks ago. It was supposed to warm up later this week, so that's a good thing. Please join me in a prayer. Thank you, God, once again for this opportunity to gather in your house to worship you. You, Lord, are the audience of one. And we're reminded that you said where two or more are gathered in your name, you are there in their midst. So we invite you in our midst this morning. May the words we sing and preach and speak, may the thoughts that cross through our minds, may the gifts we bring, may the fellowship we share be acceptable to you, our Creator, our Sustainer, and our Savior. For we are nothing without you. We ask these things in Jesus' name. Amen. Hear the call to worship. Please stand as we read from Psalm 97, verses 9 to 12. For you, O Lord, are the most high over all the earth. You are exalted far above all gods. Let those who love the Lord hate evil. For he guards the lives of his faithful ones and delivers them from the hand of the wicked. Light is shed upon the righteous and joy in the upright of heart. Rejoice in the Lord, you who are righteous. Praise his holy name. And as you remain standing, I invite you to turn in your hymnal to number 337, Nothing But the Blood of Jesus, an old Baptist hymn that I grew up reading.
Nothing but the blood of Jesus.
morning's scripture is found in John 8th chapter, verses 42 to 47, page 1663 in your pew Bibles. That's the 8th chapter of John, verses 42 to 47, page 1663. And the Bible says, Jesus said to them, "If God were your Father, you would love me. For I came from God, and now I am here. I have not come on my own, but he sent me. Why is my language not clear to you? Because you are unable to hear what I say. You belong to your father, the devil, and you want to carry out your father's desire. He was a murderer from the beginning, not holding to the truth, for there is no truth in him. When he lies, he speaks his native language, for he is a liar and the father of lies. Yet, because I tell the truth, you do not believe me. Can any of you prove me guilty of sin? If I am telling the truth, why don't you believe me? He who belongs to God hears what God says. The reason you do not hear is that you do not belong to God." May the Lord and his blessing to the reading and the hearing of his word. I invite you to continue looking in your inside of your bulletin as we read the responsive reading together. I will read what's in light print if you all will follow along by reading aloud as we move forward. "The Lord put a new song in my mouth, a hymn of praise to our God.
Many will see and hear and put their trust in the Lord.
Blessed is the one who makes the Lord his trust, who does not look to the proud, to those who turn aside to false gods.
Many, O Lord, my God, are the wonders you have done, the things you planned for us, no one can recount to you. Were I to speak and tell of them, they would be too many to declare."
Amen. We come to that time in our service where we go to the Lord in prayer, and then we conclude by saying the Lord's Prayer together. But before we do, as we do each Sunday, this is the time to invite you, if you have a specific praise, something the Lord has done wonderful in your life, that you would like to share with the congregation, this is that time. And also, if you have something that you would like to, for the congregation to join you in prayer with, this is the time as well to share that. Also, each week you will notice in the back of your bulletin, there's an ongoing list of special prayer needs that we have. So at this time, does anybody have any special praise that something the Lord's done wonderful to you or with you that you would like us to celebrate with you? Yes, sir.
I just want to thank the Lord that my daughter Lindsay served me doing very well down in Alabama. She's from Carbon High School, and my wife will be home tomorrow.
That's your daughter? Anybody else? Yes, ma'am. Hang on, so I can hear you. What other prayer requests do you have that you would like us to join? Yes, ma'am.
I'm sorry, I'm terrible at hearing.
Well, let's go to the Lord in prayer, shall we? I invite you to pray with me. Dear Heavenly Father, once again, we are so blessed to be in your house today. We are blessed to be in a place that we can worship in freedom. For we know that there are brothers and sisters in Christ who are worshiping at literal risk of their own lives in other places around the world. And yet we live in a land where people have fought and died for us to have this freedom of religion, freedom to gather. And Lord, that we don't take that lightly. So we've chosen to come to your house today and gather with your brothers and sisters in Christ to worship you. And I ask that you would bless those who made this effort today to gather in this place and in all other places around the world to worship you. Bless us, Lord, because we're there for one reason, and we need you in our lives. So I ask that you would come into our lives and come into our families and give us hope, because this is truly a dangerous world that we live in. And Lord, and first and foremost, Lord, we've all seen the news, we've heard the news, and we at Fort Bragg are intimately connected to what is going on over there in Ukraine. And when we say over there, it's not so much over there, it's part of us. Those of us who have been to war or deployed before, it's very much a part of us. It brings back a lot of memories, it brings back a lot of emotion. And then we know we have so many from this post who are in Eastern Europe protecting the NATO countries, Lord, and they're working hard, and they're receiving the many Ukrainian refugees. Lord, we ask that you would keep them safe. Lord, we pray for those people still in Ukraine that are defending their nations, that are defending their very homes, that are defending their lives. We pray for them, Lord. We pray for our enemies, Lord. We pray that they lay down their tools of invasion, that they turn back, that they stop. Lord, for we know that there are Christians who worship you, who are invading Ukraine. But we ask that you compel their spirit to turn back, to stop destruction. We pray for those, so many, who have already lost loved ones. We pray for those who are hovering in fear right now and hiding in Ukraine, not knowing if they're going to make it out alive. We pray for the children. We pray for the most helpless, who really, they can't even walk on their own. Lord, we pray for them. Our hearts are just broken. Our hearts are broken for not just in Ukraine, but around the world. There are so many people that suffer. Lord, sin is in our lives. It's in our world, and it's such a destructive force. We need you, Lord. We pray specifically for this Ukrainian situation. We lift that up to you in our prayers, Lord. We need your divine intervention. We need a miracle. And Lord, I know you are the person to deliver that miracle. Whatever that looks like, whatever that looks like, Lord, you can provide it. I ask that you would be with our leaders, not only in our country, our elected leaders, our military leaders who are making decisions, doing the best they can to try to figure out a peaceful resolution to this. It is not easy. There are no easy answers. So, Lord, please give them wisdom beyond what they already have. Give them wisdom. Help us to peacefully resolve this. The end result, Lord, help these Ukrainian citizens retain their nation. We look forward to the day that they can live in peace once again. I believe in the future. But Lord, and during this process, I just ask for your intervention. May we do what we can from where we are to support, in even a small way. We do what we can. pray for the families of our deployed service members around this country. Their immediate families, their spouses, their children, their extended families, their parents, their loved ones. It's scary when someone goes off to do their nation's work and we don't know what it's like where they are. Get worried, scared. Lord, I ask that you would be with all the families of those, because it's not just the service member that serves the country, it's the family that serves the nation. So we ask for your touch in their lives. Lord, you've heard these praises this morning. Bill's daughter, surgery went well. We thank you for that, Lord. You are a great healer. Thank you that Bill's wife will be home. Lord, there are many others who are awaiting surgeries. There are many others whose surgery has not gone well. And that's not lost on us. We pray for those who are in physical suffering, Lord. We pray for your touch in their lives. We pray for Joyce, who's diagnosed with this illness, Lord. Again, there are many others who like Joyce, hear this news, and it devastates them. Lord, we just ask for your intervention. Lord, you've heard the unspoken prayer request, but we know that even now, people, loved ones, friends come to our minds across this congregation. We lift those unspoken prayer needs up to you. We lift them up to you, Lord, because we know that we don't know the answers in those situations, but we trust you that you do. So we ask for your intervention. Lord, we ask for these continuing health concerns that are Ms. Stewart, Ruby Jones, Nat Paul. We ask for your touch on the lives of those grieving the loss of loved ones. We ask for our Christian missionaries and the persecuted church around the world. And Lord, even across our land, even though we have so many houses of worship, there are so many empty places at the table. So many folks have forgotten you, forgotten to return to you. Lord, I ask that you pierce their hearts and help them to realize that in this world, there's so many issues that we cannot solve them without you, Lord. We need you. Help us to return to you. Help us to never take you for granted. Help us to carve out time in our schedules to return to you. Carve out time in our resources to get back to you. We pray for this chapel service, Lord, that you would draw more people to this chapel service, that you would draw more chaplains to this service, Lord. We pray for the religious support office on this Fort Bragg, that you would guide them as they seek to serve all of the service members and their families on this post, in this community. We pray especially for the office of the Chief of Chaplains, Lord, in times when there are conflicts around the world. That is no easy task. How do you provide for the religious needs of all the people, regardless of their religion? It's not an easy task, Lord. We pray that you would call out more people in the civilian world to join the ranks, to be truth and light, representing you among our armed forces. We also pray specifically, Lord, I offer a prayer for the work of the counselors on this post, especially who are working over at the Watchers Center to help people find healing in their relationships, in marriages, and within themselves, even those in the behavioral health department, people who are just lost their way in life, Lord, I ask that you would intervene and help them find that inner healing and peace of mind and heart, Lord, because we know that you created us in your image, and we know that sin has an awful effect on our lives, and it destroys us from within, and it wrecks our relationships, Lord, and we need not only exterior help, Lord, but we need your touch as well. So I ask that you be healing presence on this Fort Bragg community and in the lives and the relationships of all those connected to Fort Bragg. And as we continue to worship you, Lord, we ask that you would hear our prayer as we say together, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. We come time for our tithes and offerings.
Thank you.
This morning's sermon is titled, For Those That Ask, All or Nothing. It's all or nothing. Today we'll continue looking at Paul's letter to the Christians at Galatia as we press on towards the end of this book. We have just a couple more Sundays in this series, and then we prepare for Easter. And then we will begin a series on various prayers found throughout the Bible. Remember when we read this letter to the Galatians, that when Paul wrote his letters, he did not divide them into chapters and verses, but he wrote them on scrolls that were read publicly in those churches that were pretty much gathered in small houses. But the people who assembled the New Testament in the 2nd and 3rd centuries, many of whom were Christian monks, they're the ones that added the chapters and verses to these letters to help them fit their format. So when we read the letters of Paul, this is why it seems that his complete thoughts spill over from one chapter to the next. And in this particular letter, we have already seen that Paul is quite passionate and outspoken about the recent behavior of the Christian believers at Galatia. I mean, I come to think of it, when I read all of Paul's letters, man, this is the one he is most passionate about. I mean, Paul sounds pretty upset when he writes this letter. Listen to our text found in chapter 5, verses 1 through 12. And see if you've noticed anything familiar. Those of you that have been here the last several Sundays, see if you notice anything familiar, something you might have heard Paul talk about already. So I'll be reading from the New International Version, the large print of NIV. It is for freedom that Christ has set us free. Stand firm, then. Do not let yourselves be burdened again by a yoke of slavery. Mark my words. I, Paul, tell you that if you let yourselves be circumcised, Christ will be of no value to you at all. Again, I declare to every man who lets himself be circumcised that he is obligated to obey the whole law. You who are trying to be justified by the law have been alienated from Christ. You have fallen away from grace. For through the Spirit we eagerly await by faith the righteousness for which we hope. For in Christ Jesus, neither circumcision nor uncircumcision has any value. The only thing that counts is faith expressing itself through love. You are running a good race. Who cut in on you to keep you from obeying the truth? That kind of persuasion does not come from the one who calls you. A little yeast works through the whole batch of dough. I am confident in the Lord that you will take no other view. The one who is throwing you into confusion, whoever that may be, will have to pay the penalty. Brothers and sisters, if I'm still preaching circumcision, why am I still being persecuted? In that case, the offense of the cross has been abolished. As for those agitators, I wish they would go the whole way and emasculate themselves. Now, the first verse continues the theme from last week's message. That because of what the Lord Jesus has done for us, and through His Holy Spirit, we are free, not like slaves who are subject to some master. Verses 2 through 6, we see again how upset Paul is with the believers in Galatia. He's upset because they now have apparently listened to someone else, who someone convinced the men who were never circumcised before, that they now must convert to Jewish practices in order to follow the risen Jesus, only because Jesus was Jewish. Paul reminds them that if they insist on choosing this path, which has nothing to do with the gospel, then they better go all the way. Go big or go home, Paul is saying. We can almost hear his sarcasm in his warning to them. Okay, guys, you want to be circumcised in order to please and worship God? You want to follow a set of laws that I never told you to follow? Well, just know this. Risen Jesus Christ will be of no use to you anymore, for you will have tossed him aside to follow some practice that's not part of the gospel. And also, if you want to do that, then you just open yourselves up to obey the entire set of Jewish laws. How many times do I have to tell you, Galatian believers, that if you insist on going from simply trusting in Jesus and receiving his Holy Spirit to now following a set of religious laws, you have just voluntarily fallen away from grace and freedom in Christ to willingly take on the shackles of slavery. You have alienated yourselves from Jesus Christ and the community of true believers. You used to be enslaved to sin, then you became free in Christ. So what in the world has compelled you to try to take on this new slavery to religious laws and try to impress someone? Paul reminded them that if they worship Jesus Christ, whether or not a man is circumcised, it has no spiritual value at all. It has nothing to do with faith in Christ Jesus. And it is just a person's, or better yet, a parent of an infant's personal choice. Instead, the only thing that matters, Paul said, is faith in Jesus expressed through love. We don't have to impress someone to try to prove them how much of a believer in the Lord we are. That's an easy trap for folks to fall into, though, isn't it? Even in 2022. In verses 7 and 8, Paul reminded them that they were doing so well after they received the Holy Spirit. You're doing so well. You're running such a good race in your faith. So who cut in on you to take your eyes off the finish line? Who distracted them? It certainly could have been the Holy Spirit, remarked Paul. Now, I completed a 26-mile marathon in my life on March 17, 2013, that's 9 years ago. It was in downtown Atlanta, Georgia, where we started in Centennial Olympic Park. We ran past the Carter Center, past Little Five Points, out through downtown Decatur, back through the Georgia Tech campus, to the start-finish line. The time limit was 7 hours. I completed several half marathons, but I had never attempted a full. My goal was to simply finish within 6 hours, because this was a brutally hilly course, and I am not a runner by nature. And these days, I can't run at all any sort of real distance due to lower leg injury. I'm a professional profile walker these days. But that day, when I hit the halfway point out in Decatur, I felt the voice in my head mocking me, saying things like, "This is hard, isn't it? What were you thinking? You should have just signed up for the half. You'll never make it. And you heard this much, and you got another whole 13 miles to go, mostly uphill. You'll never make it in time, if you make it at all." Luckily, an older gentleman who ran marathons during his retirement, he would help others complete their own. He came alongside me, and he paced me the entire second half of the race.
As I struggled and I could feel my legs go numb with pain, my new mentor kept encouraging me while I was trying to silence the voice in my head telling me to quit. And also I can look back and hear the sag wagon. I can see the sag wagon coming, and I know, man, that wagon better not pass me, because if it does, I have to hop on and ride to the finish line. No, I'm going to beat that wagon. So we passed lots of pockets of spectators along the way, but as the hours were grown on, those pockets of spectators kind of dispersed. There weren't many left. Mostly those who were supporting the runners. But a few who held signs like, why could you run? Why are you running when you can sit on the couch? I even saw a few signs that said, better you than me. Now, when we ran past some fraternity houses near Georgia Tech, someone had placed a table with a large cooler of cold beer and snacks on it. The sign said, take a break and have a free beer on us. Man, that was so tempting. But the finish line was only 5 miles away. So the distractions were trying to cut in on me in my goal of finishing my marathon. When the pain in my legs was strong, man, those distractions seemed so powerful. Yet my mentor kept on encouraging me, and he promised me that if I just keep my legs moving forward and never quit, we would make it on time. I refocused and kept thinking of the moment when I would run through the finish line chute and they would place that shiny shamrock medal around my neck, the medal that had the words, bring your best, engraved on it. When we got within a quarter of a mile to go, I heard the loudspeakers blaring one of my favorite songs by the group Kansas. Carry on, my wayward son, there'll be peace when you are done. Lay your weary head to rest, don't you cry no more. Man, I found my second wind, and I realized I had made it. I pushed hard that final stretch and completed my one and only marathon in 6.5 hours on legs I couldn't feel anymore. I learned how difficult it was for an untrained person to complete a full marathon. But I was proud to achieve that bucket list I had on my. And I'm grateful for my new friend and mentor who helped me complete my race. He helped me keep focused, much like Paul was trying to do with the Galatians, reminding me not to listen to those who would cut in on my race and distract me from a successful finish. That's what Paul was trying to do, run alongside them any way he could, using any verbiage and tools in his arsenal to try to say, listen, you've got the Holy Spirit. Stay focused. Don't veer off. Keep going. Keep going. When life is hard, keep going. You can make it. You will make it. But sometimes life is too hard. They took their eyes off the prize. They want to go a different direction. Do it themselves. Paul was warning the Galatians in verse 9 and 10 that just a little bit of yeast works for the whole batch of dough. Now, I'm not a chef or a baker, but those of you are, you understand how that works. It's going to take a little bit of yeast, right, to affect the whole loaf. Just a little bit. So I think, in other words, Paul was saying that even just a small number of believers who suddenly become legalistic, they can have a great influence over the entire group. So the distractors and a few that want to keep the others from remaining faithful to the gospel must be silenced. The one, whoever that was, who was confusing the Galatians, turning their eyes off Jesus and on the legalistic living, had to be silenced for sure. These detractors who believe they must follow Jewish laws to the point of circumcising themselves are very harmful to the Galatian congregation. Paul uses logic in verse 11 and asks them a good question. See, he's both Jewish and a Roman citizen, yet he's a disciple of Jesus Christ, a true believer. Before he became Paul, remember, he was Saul. And there was a time he did preach to follow the law and the legalistic codes and to get circumcised. but not anymore. So he asked the Galatians that if he was still preaching the old way, that everyone had to be circumcised according to Jewish law, then why would he continue to be persecuted now by Jewish people who were angry that he had left their fold to become a Christian believer? The very fact that Paul was no longer preaching that folks had to follow strict religious laws in order to please God was the very reason he was being persecuted and imprisoned. Why couldn't the Galatians even see that? Verse 12 shows us that Paul has sort of a sense of sarcastic humor, but he uses it to make his point quite clear, doesn't he? Look, he says, as far as those who are stirring you up, agitating you, and trying to get you to follow religious laws, and above all, to get you to circumcise yourselves, I just wish they'd go all the way and emasculate themselves from the rest of you. That way the rest of you can finish the race. Paul's trying to tell them in our text this morning that if they're going to follow Jesus through the Holy Spirit, there is no middle ground. You can't follow the Holy Spirit and try to be legalistic at the same time. It's all or nothing. You're either going in all the way for the Lord, or give the Lord nothing and go for legalism. You can't have it both ways. In conclusion, friends, understand what Paul is saying. You either allow the Holy Spirit to set you free from religious law and legalistic, falsely pious behaviors to oppress God or others, or you willingly become slaves of legalism that gets you nowhere. The Lord doesn't care what you look like, what gender you are, what race you are, what your education is, what your job is, where you come from, how much money you have or you don't have, what your rank is or your title, or especially whether or not you're circumcised. The Lord cares about what's in your heart and how you treat others. It's not about how righteous you appear to others or what you wear to church. It's not about whether you wear a cross or have a Christian symbol or sticker on your vehicle, or the fact that you can quote a few Bible verses. What matters is if you've given your life to Jesus Christ and you see others as Jesus did, and try your best to love your neighbor as yourself, and know that a lot of times your neighbor is not somebody you normally hang out with anyway. What matters is if you confess your sins and be humble and be real, and you cry out to God saying, Jesus, here I am, with my faults and all, I'm not worthy to receive the freedom you give me and the power you gave me through your Holy Spirit. But I confess my sins before you and open my hands and my heart and my mind and my soul to you. I willingly take you into my life and become the Lord of my past, my present, and my future. Guide my path forward. Help me to run this race to the finish, wherever that finish is. Thank you for the freedom of not having to impress you or others in false piety. You know my innermost being, the real me. I can't fool you, Lord, one bit. Yet you still love me somehow enough to give me eternal life. Die on the cross for me. You still love me. You still have gone to prepare a place for me. When I get distracted, worrying, and life is overwhelming, and I start to worry about what others think about me, help me to refocus on you. What you know about me is most important. Thank you for saving me, Lord Jesus. I look forward to that day in your time when I can live with you. Till that day, Lord, help me to keep my eyes on you and not stray off the course into practices, no matter how religious sounding they are, that have nothing to do with truly serving you and living in the light of your
your true gospel. May I give you all of me, for I am nothing without you, Lord. It's all or nothing for you, Lord. And I give you it all. May that be my prayer. Amen.
Let us now stand and turn to page number 571. We will sing Trust and Obey, verses 1, 4, and 5.
And may God take your hearts and set them on fire. Through the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit.